Give it a couple more seconds. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Welcome to everyone. On behalf of our co-conveners, the Safe Seaweed Coalition and the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative, I'm truly delighted to welcome you all to this United Nations Food System Summit Science Days side event on domestication for sustainable seaweed aquaculture, a major research challenge for the future of blue food systems. My name is Nichola Dyer, and it's my privilege to serve as the moderator for this important dialogue that brings together some of the leading researchers and voices on seaweed domestication to speak about research challenges and the linkages with the Sustainable Development Goals, the SDGs, especially SDG 2. Let's go through a few details before we get into the substance of the event. First, you'll have noticed that this event is being recorded. That is going to help us to effectively capture the points that will be made in the next 90 minutes. Second, we have a graphic recording artist, Asia Vignanelli, who will be capturing her vision of our conversation throughout. So Asia has just turned on her video very briefly so that we can see her. And then she's going to go away and the next you see of her will be her scribes, and you'll periodically be seeing her scribes. But now you know the face behind the scribing. Thank you, Asia. Third, we would like to know more about you, the audience, and what you're hoping to get out of this event. So to do that, we have devised some highly serious polls. Well, some of them are serious, but some less so, you'll see. We're gonna ask you three quick questions now using a poll. So Allison, could you please do the poll deployment? You will now see three questions up on your screen, and please do answer those questions to the best of your ability or to the best of what you would like to get out of this. The first one is, what would you like to get out of it? The second is your seaweed knowledge level as of now. And the third one, well, you'll see. So I see so far not too many people have voted, so please go ahead and vote. It's really important to us to know what you're interested in, and whether it's the evolution of seaweed domestication, or whether it's institutional and regulatory issues, or anything in between, you know, please feel free. So that's question one. And then question two is your seaweed knowledge level. And question three is basically, when did you last eat seaweed? So far we only have like 10 people who have who've responded. It's getting up there. Because I think let's have at least half of the participants to have voted, maybe even three quarters if we can. Allison, how's it looking to you? Think we should get ready to share the results with everybody? I think it's time. We've got 54% of the votes in, 58%. Let's go for it.
Okay.
All right.
Paul, and I'm sharing the results now.
Very good. So now you'll be able to see that people are interested in, we seem to have a tie between trends and research needs, seaweed's contribution to improving our food system, and issues on food and livelihoods in developing countries. I'm sure if we had more people who had responded, we would have had responses covering all of that. The next, so there's somebody in here who's like, you can eat seaweed. Thank you very much. There's four of you. And then several who were at an intermediate level. And then quite a few who are, I eat, live, and breathe seaweed. And that is proven out by the response to the third question, which is, many of you have eaten seaweed at least once within the past week, which I can't answer the poll because I'm moderating, but I'm in that category. So there we go. Thanks, Allison. If you can stop that share now, and we will get back to the rest. That was really great. Thank you so much for participating in the poll. Now I'm going to give you a little context before I take you through the agenda and introduce our speakers. As many of you are likely aware, the UN Secretary General is going to convene a food systems summit in New York in September 2021. That's going to be on the margins of the General Assembly. This summit is about working together to transform the way the world produces, consumes, and thinks about food. It's about achieving more healthy, more sustainable, more resilient, and more equitable food systems at local, national, and global levels. Food systems dialogues are a key part of the groundwork for this summit. These dialogues aim to bring together a diversity of stakeholders, including voices that are seldom heard, and provide an opportunity for participants to debate, collaborate, and take action towards a better future. They give us a chance to connect, to meet new partners, inspire, and be inspired. Their outcomes are formally channeled back into the summit planning process and its outcomes. And there are three kinds of food system summit dialogues. They're independent, like this one, convened by anyone who wishes to do so. Member state, which are organized by national governments, and that's really important for those of you who might want to connect with your own governments on this, and global dialogues, which are aligned with global events on major issues like climate and the environment, to name just two. Also, so I'm almost through this, but there's still a bit. In the lead up to the summit itself, there's going to be a pre-summit in Rome at the end of July. Registration for that is open now, and you can check on the summit website and you'll find all the details. Plus, at the end of this week, on July 8th and 9th, will be the Science Days. The side events to the Science Days, which have been held from last Monday through today, offer an opportunity for partners to present their insights on science, technologies, and innovations that can drive food systems transformation. Our event today is an official side event to the upcoming Science Days. It's an independent dialogue. All of the context is over. Now, preparing you. In today's event, we're going to hear from leading researchers and leaders in the world of seaweed on various aspects of seaweed domestication and the implications for the achievement of SDG 2. Our dialogue will begin with a keynote by Dr. Myriam Valero of the French National Research Center, CNRS, who'll describe the evolution of seaweed domestication. We'll then move to a panel where four panelists from around the world will take us through their perspectives on seaweed domestication, including applications in specific contexts. The panelists will be Alejandro Buschmann of the Universidad de Los Lagos in Chile. Apologies for pronunciation, Alejandro. Al-Jeria Abdul of Seadling in Malaysia. Flower Msuya of the University of Dar es Salaam and the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative in Tanzania, who's also one of our co-conveners. And Vincent Dumezel of Lloyd's Register Foundation, the United Nations Global Compact, and the Safe Seaweed Coalition, who's coming to us from France. After the panel, we'll have a Q&A session with all of our speakers where you'll have an opportunity to ask any of the speakers questions. Then Vincent, wearing several hats of Lloyd's Register Foundation, UNGC, and the Safe Seaweed Coalition, we'll share some observations about the event. And finally, I'll close with a word of thanks. In case you have questions or you'd like to make comments, please feel free to put them in the chat anytime, and the panelists will either respond directly in the chat or I will relay them during the Q&A for a live response. Plus, we're going to be saving the chat. With that, let's begin. It's now my honor to turn to Myriam Valero of CNRS for our keynote address on the evolution of seaweed domestication. Myriam, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Hello to everybody. So I think that my talk will be quite challenging, saying the response to the first question, because I want to focus on the ecological and evolutionary point of view of seaweed domestication. Next slide, please. So in fact, domestication is a long and complex process during which domesticators, and domesticators are usually humans, but there is other domesticators, if not only humans, select and modify organisms that can develop well in the domesticator's eco-environment, which are usually humans, and express threats of interest for human use. So domestication can be seen as a co-evolutionary process, and this is what I will present in this talk. And then the research in these topics are really interesting because, of course, it will provide fundamental advances in the field of evolution. But it is also really interesting because you can study the consequences of domestication, and this will help you to understand the present day issues of sustainability and biodiversity loss.
It's okay, keep going, Myriam. Okay. The recording.
What are the various steps of the trajectory from white to domesticated seaweed? And then we will see how better integration of knowledge on ecology and the genetic diversity of white population and on the selective pressure exerted by cultivators can promote sustainable seaweed aquaculture in which we are really interested. So next slide, please. So first, focus on the history of the human interaction with seaweed. In fact, there is a long history of human interaction with some species of seaweed. And this is relatively not well known in comparison with what is known in land plant or in animal in which there are many reports about the history during the Neolithic stage. But this varies a lot among seaweeds, but there is a study by Dilloé here that was published in Science that mentioned in the site of the archaeological site of Monte Verde site, which is in the southern Chile, as you can see here in the map, in which they found some seaweeds that were well preserved in the site. And so this report the fact that seaweed were gathered and consumed for food or medicine at least more than 40,000 years ago during the Neolithic. So there is a long history. Next slide, please. Then if we look at this history, I have just make a brief summary with important dates. First, the earliest written records of human interaction with seaweed originate from Japan. Century in Asia, many for food began at certain dates in which the seaweed use increased over all the world, and it was just after the World War Second World War. It's difficult to say. And because in that place, the chemical industry took over the commercial use of seaweed, mainly from harvested seaweed for the extraction of polysaccharides at that period. Next slide, please. So now that we have the global see about this principal historical date, I will focus on the different steps of the domestication process. So I have no mouse, but I will try to do that with Alison. So we are going from the place here about the management period. So during this management period, that is also called the pre-domestication period, in fact, the humans remove the competitors and modify the species environment. So you can see that from the natural stand, with just the figure upstairs, they remove the competitor and the pest. And so then the process of selection began in this modified environment by humans. And at that period, when the human knows a little bit about the species, then they could begin to reproduce the species, either clonally or bisexual reproduction. And then this action begin to modify some traits that are linked to the life cycle, the traits in which humans have some interest. And then we go to the next graph here, where you see that, for example, they select for growth, and you see that most of the seaweed are bigger because they select for this trait, and they take the parents that produce the progeny that are biggest. And then once they have selected these traits, they begin to propagate and to spread the organism all over the world and among different human ecosystems. And here you have a very rapid geographical radiation of the domestication. So during this stage, human exerts major evolutionary forces. And this is why I think that evolution can help to understand what is happening in domestication. So they increase the dispersal of the species, and they also apply selected forces that critically alter the species and its environment. So next slide, please. So here, I will look at the steps of the domestication process. I told before that are in the arrows, the green arrows here. And I will look at the effect on the genetic diversity. Below the gray arrow, here you have the different history of domestication and point out in the previous slide. And then below here, you have the white population, that is the oval population, that and you see the evolution of the white population over time. And above in the square, you have the cultivation compartment, the square, the rectangle. And so, as you can see at the beginning, there is during the Neolithic, there were only the natural population. And then it begins to have the cultivation part that arose in the world. And what you can see here is that going to the modern ages, the part of the white population about the distribution of the world in the world of the species is reducing in comparison with the cultivation part. So besides the change in selection that we see in the previous slide, domestication is also a series of repeated stochastic processes. In fact, what's happened is that for cultivation, there is only a small part of the white population, as you can see in the black hole, the first black hole here, that go to the cultivation department. And so this reduced sampling in order to cultivate the species is really reducing genetic diversity within the compartment of the cultivated compartment. What's happened, in fact, and you can see here with the black arrows, is that there is still, because we are in the same species, there is still some possible of genetic exchanges between the white compartment and the cultivated compartment. And these exchanges can reintroduce some genetic diversity within the cultivation compartment. So what's happened is that the when you see the history of this domestication process on genetic diversity, in fact, the ever need of raw material and the difficulty of exploiting the natural population in a sustainable manner are forcing humans to move first from gatherers, fishers, to then cultivators, and now they are becoming marine agronomists. So please, can you show the next slide? In fact, I will take an example of one of the work we have done with Marie-Laure Guillemin on the species that is goes called Gracilaria chilensis that you found in the, along the coast of Chile, but now it is called Agarophyton chilensis. Okay, just the seaweed often change names within the taxonomical point of view. Okay, this species is able to reproduce both sexually and asexually. Oh, here it is also a challenge to show this slide with the mouse. Okay, let's go from the tetrasporophyte, that is a diploid plant. Okay, so this is a sexual cycle. I want to show because this tetrasporophyte is producing tetraspore by meiosis that give birth to male and female gametophytes that you can see on the graph. And then fertilization occurs on the female plant to produce spore that will germinate again on the tetrasporophyte. So this is the circle that you see from the tetrasporophyte, the male and female gametophyte. Okay, this is the reproductive cycle. And then this is characterized by the liberation of spores. And then the spores has to germinate in order to give birth to individual. So they need a substrata to do that. And the other part of the life cycle is the vegetative asexual propagation of the individual. And this is what is shown for the different kind of individual, the tetrasporophyte, the gametophyte, male and female, the little arrow that you can see here. And this, can occur in a muddy habitat because it's just a fragmentation. Can you see, can you show the next slide, please? And so what's happening in this species is that the reproductive mode is associated to different kinds of habitats. So because the spore needs a favorable substratum for fixation, you have mainly sexual reproduction on the rocks, on the rocky habitat. And because the mud is an environment that is favorable for talus fragmentation, then you have preferentially vegetative propagation on the mud. And for the cultivation, in fact, the farmer used the ability of clonal propagation to multiply the species within estuaries or muddy habitats. And we have shown that this has profoundly modified the life history traits of the species. And this, because the species reproduce vegetatively, it is a process that can go very quickly. And in 50 years, there were a selection for diploidy and asexuality that occur in farms. And this had a profound effect on the genetic diversity and reduced a lot the genetic diversity of the species. And another side effect was that there was an increased epiphytism in farms. And this is what I want to discuss more in the next slide now, focusing on the assessment of environmental risk that aquaculture or domestication can have. And going again on the example of Gracilaria chilensis, here you can see that you have the white stock and the crop stock. And what's happened is that with vegetative propagation, there are lots of pathogens that can attack an epiphyte that can attack the same genotype. And then within the crop compartment, it is a kind of reservoir of all these pathogens and epiphytes for the species. And when in Chile, what's happened is that there were massive transportation of the algae biomass to stock or establish new farms all along the Chilean coast. And this transportation of the crop compartment then favor the spread of associated pests and pathogen over the range distribution of the species. And this had also a very negative effect on the biomass production, because then it decreased really dramatically for that species that was cultivated in Chile. The other example I want, the other assessment of environmental risk, next slide please, is the fact that the domesticated strain can become invasive. And this is because the, again, you have the two compartments here, and it is because the cultivation, the cultivated population occupy the same space than the wild stock. And then sometimes they can be a better competitor than the wild individual. And then when you spread the species over different, over the world, then the species that you cultivate can escape from aquaculture and become an invasive species. And it is, for example, what was reported for the species on Daria prenatifida. The next environmental risk in the next slide, please, is that, again, as I said, there is possibility of gene exchanges between the wild and the wild stock and the crop stock. And in that case, it is what it is called generally genetic pollution. Then you can have some genes that come from the crop compartment that go in the wild. So this is, for example, problems that were mentioned for the genetically modified organisms that go to the wild. But there is also other problems that can arrive because the genes that are going to the wild are not well adapted to their environment, and they can decrease the genetic diversity and then have dramatic effect on the wild population. So in conclusion, I would, next slide please. So in conclusion, I would say that you can see domestication as an eco-evolutionary process. I hope that I convinced you, in which you have the three actors, the seaweed, the humans, and the environment that interact together and that will make profound change between them. So research on seaweed domestication should be oriented towards management practice and breeding strategies that will allow the maintenance of the domesticated evolutionary potential, because we see that then you will lose your domesticated species. And this includes the choice of source population, which population you will choose, and the selection of varieties that will be suitable for sustainable agriculture system in this context of spatial and temporal environmental variability. So this is an important question, because domestication and aquaculture surely will allow us to increase the availability of resources that we need for the seaweed. We cannot only rely on harvesting. So the next slide is a conclusion again, because in fact, as it is an evolutionary relationship, you can in fact have a co-evolution between the domesticator and the domesticated species. This has been well reported. I don't know if you heard about it in animals, for example, and you have the classical example of the lactose tolerant population in Europe, because they were domesticated the cows, and the way they eat were really changed by the fact that they drink a lot of milk, and then they have adapted to a lactose tolerance in adult in European population, which is not the case all over the world. And for the algae, we may have this kind of process that is occurring, because in the example of Piropia, as you can see in the paper of Hermann here, because they studied the gut metagenome in the Japanese population that eat a lot of Piropia, and they found the bacteria that confer to this population a higher digestive ability compared to what's happened in the in the other population of the world. So this may be the co-evolutionary aspect, that the co-evolutionary process that is in the process. So finally, in the context of this day, where we ask, can seaweed domestication help achieve sustainable development goal for reducing to end the hunger in the human population? There is a large research agenda out there on the possible pathway by which seaweed domestication could help with this achievement, and we will see that during this day. Thank you very much. And the final slide is about the thanks to the program that financed this work and the researcher with which I collaborate. And you can see in particular that there is the team of Alejandro here that helped to think about this question. Thank you to the organization and thank you to everybody for your attention.
And thank you to you, Myriam. That was fantastic. It really set the stage and you got everybody's attention, I would say right from the start, but especially the sex on the rocks. I think this will not be forgotten. There are a lot of people who were interested. I saw some great questions coming up in the chat as well. So do have a look now that you get to sit back for a little while we go to the panel. Do have a look at those questions. Feel free to answer them in the chat, but I think that some of them will be great to answer live as well. So let's come back to that. Now we are going to turn to, and I love the scribes. Thank you so much, Asya, for sharing those already. This is great. We are now going to go to the panel. And our first panelist is Dr. Alejandro Buschmann, who's going to speak to us about trends and research needs in global seaweed farming development. And I did warn the panelists, by the way, because it's such an exciting topic that sometimes people can get carried away. So they have 10 minutes max. And if it looks like that's going to be exceeded, then I have a tool. So with that, over to you, Alejandro, the floor is yours. Well, thank you.
I hope you don't need it with me. Here. So good morning or good evening. I will talk about the research needs, what we need to develop seaweed farming. Next one. So I will go very briefly, but here is an example of maize, how maize have changed over some centuries because of human modifications and selection processes. And we have in the past decades, only a few decades, improved productivity in several regions. There are differences between regions, but in any case, breeding programs has increased quite a lot productivity. Next one. So, but if we go to aquaculture, that is much less known what we have achieved yet. So here is a paper in Nature published this year, and in which aquaculture has grown in the last 20 years for 36 metric tons up to 112 tons, metric tons, a million tons, sorry. So that is 4-time increase in 20 years. That is not bad. And the good story is that the two top ones in seaweed aquaculture in general are seaweed. The Japanese kelp, Eucuma capaficus. Here is a picture in China, a picture in Indonesia about the Eucuma farming. So seaweeds are very relevant. And only these two species share 18% of all the aquaculture production in the world. All species count. And here is another top 10, Gracilaria. And there is another important one, wakame. So there is over 20% of share of all sea aquaculture production are seaweed. Next one. So seaweed are important, but the point is why we need to deal with productivity. Here we have the net present value, profit, for a suspended culture of kelp in Chile. And the next one will appear an arrow. Next one. Okay. There is a breaking point on the amount of productivity that you need. And that is 12 kilograms per square meter or 120 tons per hectare per year of production, biomass and fresh weight. But also very relevant that will affect your process is and your profitability is the selling price. Right now it's under 90 US dollars per ton. So if you do not have a higher value and at least a higher productivity than this, you will not make a business. Next one. Next one. So, breeding is relevant, and the development of culture systems is also a relevant point because you need to make available all your biomass to be in a place in which you can harvest light energy in a very efficient way. And for doing that, I will show you that selection of some morphology that may have or not some genetic background may help to increase this productivity. Next one. So here you see our floating canopy of our kelp, which is covering 100% of the sea surface, which is very different from some other production systems, in the case kelp in China, in which you see a lot of free space, which is not losing a lot of energy in those cases. Next one. People in working with microalgae have been much more rigorous on this aspect to increase yield. Next one. And just by letting you know that by increasing from 0.5% of the photosynthetic next one. So it's very important. So for light harvesting efficiency, morphology is important. How you intercept light. So morphogenesis has been in terrestrial agriculture been very important for making the important. The physiology of the plant is important, and the genetic background that makes these traits be present is also relevant. Next one. Okay, in the past years, we have been developing some mesocosm approaches to study these and to study the productivity that this paper just came out 2 weeks ago in Frontiers Plant of Plant Sciences, and that allows us to measure in a much more detailed in natural type of environment the productivity of this algae. The next one. And by doing these experiments, we have been able to demonstrate, this is not published yet, that by increasing the amount of biomass allocated to the canopy, you increase productivity. So those morphologies that have a lower ratio of sub-canopy biomass, or in this case, the number of blades that are low in deeper in the water, you have a much lower productivity. So you could increase productivity by increasing the biomass that you allocate to the surface. Next one. So what we have been doing for changing this morphology, here we have, by manipulating environmental conditions, the final gametophytes can produce different amounts of oogonia. The reproduction output can be modified. And by modifying this reproduction output, the number of fronds from the initial stages, from very small stages, are different. And we can create this multiple front and these few front morphotypes. Next one. And here it's a paper. Press another button, please. We have an experiment in which we have two distinct genetically kelp populations grown at different nutrient levels. And here is a level that is limiting. And you see that we have differences. Next one, press, you can press two times. Yeah, okay, this you see this limited. But also relevant, these red bars show you the crossing between both populations, and there is a tendency of increment, but which the increase that is very significant is that those that have showed this morphology, this multiple front morphology, which are not genetically different from the other ones, but they show this increased production. The mechanistic explanation is still to be developed, but we are working on that. But these trends are important. Next one. And genetics matter, but also non-genetically based morphological development need to be assessed. Next one. But not all seaweeds are equal. Think that different groups of algae are coming from, have different ancestors and do not behave. And that is a message that we forget sometimes. And here is the case against, as Miriam showed you, Gracilaria or Agarophyton now, that is clonally propagated. And these are data from Merylo-Guillemin.
30-second warning, Alejandro.
Yeah, I'm finishing. They have a reduced genetic diversity. Next one. However, if we culture them different panels here with different genetic diversity, you don't see a strong decrease in growth. And also the epiphytes loads change. There is some tendencies to be lower from coming from some populations, but really we do not see these striking differences yet. So I have a question mark here on this answer. This is just a PhD thesis just published by Sara Usandizaga. Okay, next one. Coming to the end, what is needed? We need to enhance yield. No question about that. And for that, we need science, technology, innovation, breeding, physiological understanding, and technological development. But we need also to add value, increase demand for seaweed. We need to add value. We need to develop new products, and we need to open new markets. If not, with the higher production, we will see a decrease in the value of seaweed in time. And that will not induce further the production of seaweed. So also regulations are very relevant. Regulations like in Chile are focused on salmon. And salmon has nothing to do with seaweed cultivation. And so many regulations are misleading, are not useful to encourage seaweed production. Thank you.
Thank you, Alejandro. That was terrific. I learned so much, and I decided not to deploy the scissors after all, because I was learning a lot. This has been really great so far, and I've seen so many exciting questions coming in the chat as well. Now we're going to turn to Al-Jeria. Al-Jeria Abdul, who's going to share her perspectives with us, excuse me, on how seaweed can help improve our food system and from the seedling perspective as well. So Al-Jeria, over to you. Thanks. You are muted, Al-Jeria. Please unmute yourself.
Yeah. So hello, everyone. I am Al-Jeria. Thank you for having me today. I'm a young and passionate marine biologist from Malaysia. When talking about ocean, it always have a special value for me because I grew up in a village, a coastal village to be exact. It is where I spent my precious childhood building a lot of memories that without me even realizing, it become the reason why I pursue my career in an ocean related business. Seeing how the community really depending on the marine resources, especially fishing, always makes me wonder, if there is no more fish, then what will happen? And I remember at one point of time, my father replied to me, "No worries, because we can always eat the plant in the ocean." And I was like, and that question being unanswered for many, many years. Up until I continue my study, then I realized the plant that he referred to is seaweed. And that's how I've been continue to fall in love with this humble organism with an aim to be an aspiring figure, especially in seaweed industry. So my talk today will be more to share our work in Seadling as a social and biotechnology company, because I think the knowledgeable aspect will be shared by the other speakers. When we talk about seaweed, it is undeniably gives more benefit to us as human. It is superfood because it has a high level of carbohydrate as well as mineral, vitamin, and trace element. As for the species that we are working with, which is Cuphophicus, it is popular for the carrageenan content, which is a storage polysaccharide that exhibit textural and stabilizing properties. Thus, they are extracted by the hydrocolloid industry. Second point is that our ocean is constitute more than half of the Earth's surface. So there is a lot to be explored. If we just continue to fish, then there will be nothing left. We already face overexploitation of fish, thus we need an alternative option. And of course, seaweed really fits the role. Moreover, it also provides opportunity for a nature-based solution to tackle environmental issues. Seaweed, it can act as a carbon sink. It helps in carbon sequestration process, thus provide a balance in the ecosystem services. It is a sustainable solution to address climate change problem. The thematic area for this food summit is based on 5 action tracks, but my sharing today will be just based on 2 action tracks, which is action track 3 and action track 4. Action track 3 aims to boost nature positive production by optimizing the environment resources in the food production, processing, and distribution. This is to avoid a negative impact to our environment, such as biodiversity loss and pollution. This is aligned with the impact program that we are establishing right now. We are collaborating with a local NGOs to analyze human behavior and attitudes towards the environmental friendly practices, because our goal is to build a model community with better sustainable farming practice.
So I'm sure this will support the aspirational outcome of the action track number three, which is to protect, manage, and restore our ecosystem for a sustainable food production. For the action track four, it states the need to advance an equitable livelihood. This is by promoting full productive employment and decent work for all related levels in the chain. It can be done by protecting and strengthening the capacities and the knowledge of the different groups to have an equal chance to contribute in the full system itself. So that's why our work in Seadling, we are working closely with the farmers because we want to promote a direct farmers-buyers relationship, which will increase the transparency of the seaweed farming chain. And we do it by establishments of a contract farming where we provide the seed, they farm, and promoting a buyback. We also encourage women participation to contribute to the best ability. Because we believe this opportunity that we open up to the women will advancing the equitable livelihood for the whole community. Even though we are still in an early stage with a risk of various issues and challenge, we are still diligently working on it because we know be a Kickstarter will help in accelerating the good impact. So maybe I can ask the technical team to share a slide, just slide of a pictures. Yeah, so basically the slide is just like the situations of the ocean seaweed farming here in Malaysia. Because I want to talk about the challenge that actually happening. This industry is still in a stone age. It is really labor intensive and still no automation available. If you guys can see, the farmers still use a manual way of tying the seaweed, the seedling individually at each rope. So it requires a lot of process. That's why we need an innovation to change this domestication process. The farmers only depending on what's available instead of coming with an option of selection. Moreover, this industry currently here suffer from a disease problem. It caused a huge economic loss, especially to the farmers, because at some point of time, the seaweed that they farm got sick and died. So they don't have any option for any income. This is why we need a controlled seed quality and thoroughly strategy as a prevention method of disease outbreak. And one of that many solutions is creating a hatchery-based seedling production system. And that's what one of our business entity here in Seadling Sundaram Berhad. Yeah, so the last slide, I guess, yeah. So before I ended it up, ladies and gentlemen, I already share our work here in Seadling, but then I want to say this action, solution, and plan need to be put in an action to be seen as a reality. I strongly encourage and support this sharing platform to promote a solution through a fruitful discussion. Let us work together and use seaweed as a pathway to address a sustainable development plan. And importantly, we will creating a better future for our next generation. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Al-Jeria. Wow, that was really powerful. And I noted this industry is still in the stone age, so there's a long way to go. And you highlighted some of the important challenges that people on the ground are facing with domestication, and you're an important part of helping things to develop. Now we're going to go to a second in-country kind of case study with Dr. Flower Msuya. So Flower is going to speak to us about the specific context of Tanzania and she will present on the challenges and interventions in domesticating seaweed for food and livelihoods in Tanzania. Flower, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nichola. And I'm glad that many people joined us. And I'm going now to make my presentation. Please, may I have the slides?
Are you seeing?
Okay. Yes. So, yes, I'm Flower Msuya from the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative. And today I'm going to talk to you about the challenges that we have been facing and we are still facing in domesticating seaweed for food and livelihood development in Tanzania. What interventions we have done and where do we want to go from now on? Next, before I go, I want you to look at
a little technical problem.
Picture on the left, that is a shallow water farm. It will give you an idea of what. So when we continue, we'll talk about the different methods. Next slide. Okay, in Tanzania, actually, we have the native seaweeds, and I'm talking about these that have already been commercialized as business, and we're talking about Kappa ficus and Yukuma. So we have species that are growing in the wild. We have Kappa ficus alvarezi, we have Yukuma denticulatum, Yukuma odontophorum, Yukuma platicladum. So all these are growing naturally in our environment. But when we want to domesticate them from their natural in order to start, we couldn't get enough biomass for commercial production. So because of this, then we had to import seaweed from the Philippines. And that's actually when commercial production started. So what we imported here from the Philippines is the Yukuma denticulata and the Kappa ficus alvarezi. That is the ones that we imported in 1989. And that is when actually commercial production started in Tanzania. Next slide. Okay, so during this time after domesticating from the Philippines into our farms, we have been seeing the challenges. You have heard a lot about these challenges, but the challenge of climate change. Climate change causing higher temperatures in our waters, especially the shallow water farms that we saw earlier. And all this causes diseases and baby fights on the seaweed. And because of this, actually, Kappa ficus now is not growing in many areas. You know, there are only very few villages, especially in Zanzibar, where Kappa ficus is still farmed because of the sensitivity of Kappa ficus to high temperatures. And generally, in the seaweed industry, actually production is going down. This is the effect of climate change. So when we saw that we had these challenges of Kappa ficus, alvarezi especially, then we wanted to, we said, what can we do? So we imported a variety of Kappa ficus now, again from the Philippines to Tanzania. And so we imported Kappa ficus striatus from the Philippines to complement or to replace the alvarezi that was dying. And we also imported a variety of Yukuma denticulata, commonly known as million, for our farms here. And also we have a small project where we're studying the native species. Now we're asking ourselves, is it the same as it used to be in the 80s and in the early 2000s? Because we were trying to get enough biomass, we couldn't. So we are looking at the native varieties for commercial production, which means we can actually domesticate these native ones. We are also developing farming technologies. It's because of the climate change. So we are now looking at deep water farming technologies to now farm seaweed in deep water than in the shallow waters where the effect of high temperature is really very, very high. And we are also adding value to the seaweed. We know that in Tanzania, we don't have a history of people eating seaweed actually, but we started training farmers, especially how to make seaweed products, how to eat the seaweed itself since 2006. And now we have more than 50 products that are used in the country, whether directly seaweed or seaweed products. Next slide. Okay, so but when we are making these interventions, we are still facing challenges. The problem of seaweed diseases and the dieback of the kappa ficus is still persistent. So we are still continuing to look into methods, studying diseases to see what we can do, because it is really persistent. We have all kinds of diseases, and we also see that in the commercial production of this seaweed as food, we have only three species that have been so far domesticated. We have kappa ficus alvarezi, kappa ficus tractus, and Yucuma denticulatum. So they are only species until now. And the deep water methods that we have so far developed, they are still not optimal. Sometimes we face the challenge of too rough sea. Sometimes, you know, farmers cannot reach there and so on. So we still have this challenge despite our deep water technologies that we have studied so far. And when we look at the seaweed products and the consumer issue, we see that among the 50 plus products that we have produced so far, less than 10 of these are food products. So it means that when we are addressing the SDG 4, when we are talking about food, when we are talking about zero hunger, we have only less than 10 products that are food products. So this is still a challenge. And these food products that we have, they have low shelf life. So they are not like widespread in the markets. It's still a challenge. And therefore the market is actually limited. And we have few people only who are consuming seaweed until now. You know, we are talking of a country with 60 million people, but only few of them are consuming seaweed. And so there's low awareness, there's low acceptance. So all these are challenges that we need to work on. Next slide, please. Okay, so we ask ourselves, what are the research needs? What do we need to do in the seaweed industry? So should we go for resistant varieties? Yes, resistant varieties of the seaweeds that we have already domesticated for commercial farming. Now the question is, should we go for genetic engineering? Yes, maybe genetic engineering to get resistant varieties. We can use things like tissue culture that are found in Asia and other countries. So this is what we need to do in research. And also we should look at new species of seaweed. We have more than 400 species growing in the waters. We have the caulepa you see here, we have the ulva, we have gracilaria, and these are already domesticated in other countries. They are being used, but we have not done that, though we need to go into research and see how we can use this for domestication. And also on a farming technology, to have really optimal farming technologies, because we have seen that we need to go into deep waters for the seaweed, especially the higher value kappa ficus, to grow. And on value addition, we need to scale up what we have, produce more food products, and also to make this the shelf life high, so that we can have these products in the market and people can eat the seaweed. And also we need to increase the awareness. Actually, market is very important. We have the whole continent of Africa where we can have seaweed products in the market. So we need to, next slide. Okay, sorry, they didn't show here, but the next slide was on the conclusion. the conclusion, which we say that we have all these kind of opportunities, we have all these technology we need to do, all this kind of research we have to do. So we want to have all this, and I would like to thank everyone for joining us today, and we hope that we will actually have a boost in the seaweed industry to address the food issue as SDG. Thank you for listening.
Thank you so much, Flower. That was really terrific, very, very helpful. I'm still learning a lot about what is happening in Tanzania, and it's great to hear you. Thanks to all for your patience with the technical issues. That's what happens when you're bringing people together from around the world. And now we've heard from the scientists, we've heard from the practitioners. Now, and we have also heard that there are some regulatory and institutional challenges. Now we're going to turn to Vincent for him to elaborate on some of those. So Vincent Dumézel of Lloyd's Register Foundation, UN Global Compact, and the powerhouse behind the creation of the Safe Seaweed Coalition. Over to you, Vincent. Thanks.
Thank you for this long introduction. I used to have a title that So I have no presentation to share just because it distracts you from looking at me, which is very bad for my ego. seriously speaking, I would like to thank first all of the previous speakers. There's a problem when you speak at the end. I mean, there's not much left to say after so many very important speakers. And actually, if you look at the gender parity in this meeting, I think contrary to what Al-Jeria said, I mean, we should open up to men actually, because I think I've been invited here just because I'm a man and to get some parity with Alejandro, because otherwise it's only women, even the scribe is a woman. So that's very cool, and that's very an important point. And that also related to the high interest from a UN perspective about this. So to get straight to the point, I fully agree with what was said. There's a lot of effort to be made in domestication. We are still in the Stone Age, clearly. I mean, we are nowhere in terms of this domestication, and civilization is based on domestication, on domesticating the wild environment. That civilization is only about it. So we have to move away from this prehistoric time in the ocean, which is so negative for the environment. Seaweed has a lot of potential. It has been highlighted here. We don't know how to cultivate that yet very well. I mean, we know we know to cultivate a few species out of 12,000, if I'm not wrong. The suitable area on the planet for seaweed cultivation should be around 66 million square kilometers, if I'm not wrong. Well, scientists say that the ocean could absorb 6 million square kilometers, and we are yet to achieve 2,000 kilometers. So there are still a big growth avenue here, and that is why it's so important for the UN to take place. And why is it so important to have the UN and everyone involved? Because we have to be all, it has to be all together. Everything can be achieved, but we have to be all together. And we see that we have not been very good in the seaweed industry to get together so far. It was very fragmented, very disconnected. We are not getting access to large funding, to large investment, to EU funding and so forth, because we are competing with land-based organizations that are so much more mature than we are and so well organized. So we are never getting the fundings. And we are still nowhere. So we have to get together, which is why we decided to set up this coalition, the Safe Seaweed Coalition. It doesn't mean that seaweed is not safe. It means that we have to work together to demonstrate to everyone that domesticating and eating seaweed is safe, which is not taken for granted by many people. There's a high level of inconsistency in the regulation worldwide, I would say. Notably from a food safety perspective, and we have to streamline and make it fully consistent to have a real global market that can create the demand and the offer and boost this resource. So we need to clarify the regulations from an institutional point of view. We are working with the FAO, And we have created the coalition. The link is there in the chat box. If you want to register, it's very important. It's free. And we have to work together to build the same standard, the same food standard, the same product standard for everyone. Importantly, as it was stressed by Myriam and others, I mean, seaweed could be invasive as well. And domestication can lead to some invasivity problems. So we have to make sure that some clear guidelines are designed to prevent this invasivity problem. And it has to be all together. If we just do it, I mean, in one university, in one country, it will not help. So we have to create this guideline to create this standard for environmental safety. And last but not least, as mentioned by Al-Jeria and others, workers, livelihood, community, we need to make sure that we are working with them, that they are safe, that they are not at risk in this new industry, that the social issues are totally clear, especially that is a big promise and hope for the emerging country. The worker safety, community safety is very important. That's the three topics: product safety, environment safety, worker safety, that we want to work on all together from the coalition. They are pure non-competitive topic. I don't think anyone will compete saying, well, my seaweed production is free of fatalities. That's not the type of thing that you may say. So that's a very strong convening power, which is why also the UN decided to back this initiative, which is also something very strong. I was, you know, as you may know, there is a big summit that was mentioned by Al-Jeria, UN Food System Summit. I was in discussion with both UNGC and UN Food System Summit yesterday. We may have a slot to voice the seaweed effort during the pre-summit in Rome through the UNGC CEO, Sandra Longabalo, who will voice directly to the UN Food System Summit the potential for seaweed. So that will be very strong. And it's a very quick rise of attention for the seaweed efforts. We have a lot of investors as well who are interested. I'm approached every week by various investors who want to invest in seaweed and who don't know how to do that. The coalition is supposed to be something to support them. Once again, we need a lot of investment in research, in piloting this research, to make domestication, to scale up this domestication process. We need to do that, and it can only be all together. So I won't be too long on this, but I think I'm still struggling to understand why we have not yet domesticated such a wide diversity of organisms that do not need land, do not need water, or do not need pesticides, and are quite unlikely to fly away or to swim away. So if we do that, I think we may be remembered as the first generation of this planet who managed to restore ocean biodiversity to feed the entire world and to bring more equity and gender parity in this world. So I think we may be remembered as such, and hopefully all together we will. Thank you, but that can only be all together. Thank you.
Terrific. Thank you very much, Vincent. That was a really great pulling it all together. And now what we're going to do is bring our panelists, so Vincent, Flower, and Al-Jeria, and Alejandro, and we're going to do a quick round on seaweed and SDG 2. So very briefly, and let's see, we've got a couple more to bring in. There we go, we're missing Al-Jeria, and she will be in, there we go. So the question to you is, how can seaweed contribute to the achievement of SDG 2? Let us start with Alejandro.
Sorry, it was an interruption in the internet. Can you repeat the question?
Understood, and thanks all for bearing with technical issues. The question is, how can seaweed contribute to the achievement of SDG 2?
Well, I think seaweed cultivation and production could solve many, many issues, and it will contribute to food safety and environmental issues, including buffering from climate change and so on. But in many of these claims, I think we need to be realistic, because for for example, for having an environmental impact, we cannot do it at small scale. This will rely to be at very large scale. And that will open human conflicts about uses that we need to study and understand and have solutions. And on the other hand, I say from the food perspective, Miriam finished with a nice paper by Henneman, in which demonstrated that coevolution of human, it's very relevant for developing a bacteria capable of digesting and making nutrients available. So how we need to wait for to that the seaweed are very useful from a food perspective for humans?
Thank you, Alejandro. That was terrific. Let us go next to Al-Jeria. Super quick, what's the contribution that seaweed can make to achieving SDG 2?
Okay, so to address the SDG 2, which is zero hunger, sustainable agriculture, and also food security. So how I can see it, like personally, is that replacing the current diet that we have with seaweed. So that means if usually you will eat meat and fish, so why not try to eat seaweed? Because like it will take the pressure from the fishing sector itself. And secondly, for the terms of cover fibers, it is used as a important cuisine here for the coastal community. So with a domestication of seaweed, where we farm more seaweed, then that will be more seaweed available for them. With the price, with the lower price that they can get the seaweed, of course, the zero hunger can be like mitigated by buying seaweed as a replacement of the food. And lastly, I can see an indirect contribution, because for the SDG 2, you have to do a sustainable farming as well. So we need to tackle the community, which is the producer itself. And like this is what we are doing with promoting more farming and get it, the seaweed is available in any way. And at the end, it can be translated as a climate change, because if we can use seaweed as a mitigation action, indirectly, the zero hunger can be end and more option to people in the world. Yeah.
Fabulous, and you escaped the scissor fate. So flower to you. Very quickly, what contribution can seaweed make to SDG 2 achievement?
I wouldn't want to repeat what has been said, but I really want to say that where there is seaweed, we need to make food out of seaweed. We have to promote seaweed as food, and then bring it to other areas where the seaweed is not there. People can learn to eat seaweed if they get the product. Another one is I've seen that people are already using seaweed as fertilizer. Actually, in Zanzibar nowadays, they just collect seaweed on the beach and they put in their plants. So we need to promote also this kind of seaweed as fertilizer to promote production of other food products for the SDG 2.
Absolutely. Thank you. That's fantastic. Vincent, in 30 seconds, anything you want to say about seaweed and SDG?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we need to have a global and more global perspective about seaweed. Seaweed is just not something to be eaten, but it's also part of a global ecosystem that is the ocean, and that contributes to less than 3% of our food while in calorie supply, while it covers 70% of the planet. Seaweed has to boost ocean production. It can replace some, it can feed our animal as well. It can participate to the ocean ecosystem, to the restoration, feed bivalves and shellfish and small fish and so forth. So indirectly, even if the nutritional standards are not really there yet and we don't know about the bioavailability of some compounds, feeding animals, feeding fishes and shellfish is a solution. So I saw some comment about IMTA. I'm a strong believer that this should be part of the regenerative aquaculture of tomorrow that has the potential as such to fix the SDG 2.
Thank you. That's a great way for us to now segue into the next part of our conversation, which let's bring Myriam back in, because there's been such an incredibly lively exchange going on in the chat. I haven't even been able to follow all of it. So our colleague, another Seaweed Squad member, Rachel, is going to help me with curating our live Q&A questions. I want to ask the first one is Carrie Max, who I think gets the award for possibly being the most active poster in the chat. Carrie, thank you for your incredibly active participation. Of your many questions, we picked the first one, your question to Al-Jeria about involving women in this opportunity. So what Carrie is asking Al-Jeria is, would there be any particular constraints to involving women relative to men in seaweed?
Yeah, so basically the biggest limitation I can see here is that the traditional perceptions of women itself by the family and the community, they always view women as like not strong enough, not fit physically, to do all the seaweed processing. But then at some point, this perception needs to be changed, but then we cannot do it directly. So that's the biggest limitation that I can see. Even like for myself, when I go to the farm, they will see me as a young girl, but suddenly she wants to do seaweed. So that perception really hits me inside. So what we can do is that right now we are working with a program to try to change the mindset to be more open to the woman in this particular process, for example, tying or maybe drying. Yeah, so that's the limitation, the family and the community perception.
And mindsets, absolutely. So we have another very prolific poster, and that is Mujibu, apologies if I didn't quite pronounce that right, in Kambo. To Myriam, has there been some work done on seaweed domestication in inland saline systems? There was quite a bit of activity on salinity and also on inland systems. So you might want to address both of those aspects. And if anybody else among the panelists would like to perhaps flower, you might want to speak to that as well. Myriam first.
Okay. I don't know any particular study for that, but as I explained, the process of domestication is to select some traits of interest in response to a modified human environment. And so in the case of inland, this is the modified human environment. And the case of low high salinity is another kind of human environment. And so then there is the process of domestication should not be very different. It's just the environment in which you select the traits that are different. But I think that if you cultivate again and again in this spatial environment, you can select it for traits of interest in that environment.
Flower, any additional thoughts on that? I see you.
Yes, I think that you need to have the required technology. For example, we are talking about seaweed. So seaweed, you have to have seawater. So you have to think of maybe land-based systems that can be used to cultivate certain types of seaweeds, not all of them. This way, it is possible to have this on land. Otherwise, then you use it to enhance other crop production as fertilizers and all kind of applications.
Okay, absolutely. Alejandro, you wanted to come in.
Yeah, one thing, if you're willing to use fresh water, and actually fresh water aquaculture is the most relevant aquaculture and much more important is marine, but research is prevalence is in marine systems. That is not a clear pattern. So we need to have more fresh water. But mostly, if you are willing to study in estuaries, then you need to select fuel to live in
Thank you. We're having a bit of trouble with your connection, Alejandro, but I think we got the gist of it. And what I think this is pointing to is what's been said several times is the research agenda is wide open here. There is just so much for anybody who's interested in going into this field. And now I wanted to turn to Rachel, who has been very carefully curating questions behind the scene. And Rachel is going to question. So Rachel, please go ahead.
Thanks, Nichola. And thank you to all the panelists for such a great discussion there. Our next question is from Charlene. And it is about diet and production, which is a topic that's come up multiple times throughout each of your talks today. Seaweed is already a big part of Eastern Asian diet and production. How can we introduce seaweed in West?
So anybody, go for it.
Yeah, I can go for it. Yeah. I think food is, sorry, Flower, I'll let you go then. I think as we mentioned that with Peter Thompson last week, I mean, food is fashion. I mean, no one was able to tell about the sushi that went popular everywhere in the world, and no, even in the small village in Tanzania, you can get sushis. So it becomes a fashion in like 20 to 30 years. So food is fashion. We can change the way people are eating. There's a long education process. I think we should be very good in telling the right story about what represents seaweed and what is seaweed. And we should learn to cook them as well, which is another story. but I think that's the two. But I think we need to be full of hope and do not think that this will be complicated. It won't be complicated. I mean, I think people are more and more concerned about what they eat and about the consequences that this could have. So I think once again, it can change very, very, very quickly.
Thank you. And Flower, you wanted to come in, and then you're going to essentially get the last word, Flower, before we turn to Vincent for some closing observations. And then I will do the word of thanks at the end. So over to you.
Okay, to have seaweed in the Western food, start restaurants that serve seaweed with Western recipes. If there's a Western restaurant, then we introduce seaweed as part of this, you know, dessert or salad or something. So if we introduce seaweed in restaurant recipes and restaurants, I think it's one way of adding to what Vincent said. I think it's one way of making these people eat seaweed also.
All right, thank you. So Vincent is going to do some quick observations, and we also want to hear from you, the audience. What are your takeaways? What did you learn? What changed for you? We're also going to be running the poll that I promised you. But any overarching messages that you heard, anything that you think can change the profile of seaweed globally during the Food Systems Summit, just anything that surprised you, please feel free to put that in the chat. We won't have time to get to all of your questions here, but we will try to make sure if you've posed them to a specific panelist, then we will ask the panelists to respond to you. So Vincent, over to you for those quick observations. We've got the great scribe from Asia. Thank you so much. Over to you, Vincent.
No, I cannot
meantime, chat member, please put in the chat. Sorry, go ahead.
I cannot compete with the scribe. I mean, it's impossible. I mean, I think all was said in the closing slide. So congratulations to Asia for this. Just would like to say that seaweed is our greatest untapped resource at the moment. The world is craving for good news. Seaweed is a very, very good news. We have to do much better than we did with the land. We have to learn from our experience on land and develop a really, not even sustainable, but regenerative aquaculture in the ocean to feed the planet and help communities and livelihood. So that's a great, great chance we have. So let's take it all together once again. I mean, there's not much more I can say, and we are running out of time anyway. So once again, I think there's a lot to be done, but we need to domesticate, and we need to remember that, I mean, indeed, women are an essential part of it. We need to remember that the one who discovered and gave birth to the most lucrative aquaculture business, that is the porphyra production in Japan, is someone called Kathleen Brubaker, who was English, who is now celebrated like a goddess in Japan. because she mastered the, she was the first to master the reproduction cycle for Porphyra, which was a real shift in the guar production that was only 50 years ago or so. So once again, we are in the early stage of seaweed domestication, but we don't have much time, so we need a lot of investment.
Great closing substance words. Now what we're going to do is we'll deploy the poll. And while we're deploying the poll, I am also going to say a few final words. One is that you can all help to spread the word about seaweed and its potential to achieve SDG 2. So please carry these messages forward into other dialogues that you might be attending. Later on today, we are going to send you a note with the key takeaways that you're contributing to now. We'll also be compiling a report that we're going to post in the coming weeks on the Food Systems Summit Dialogue website, and we'll be sharing it with all of you, and we'll be encouraging you to share it widely. So please be on the lookout for it. If you haven't already, please click on the link in the chat that that asks you the basic demographic information. We need that to prepare our report back to the summit. So please do share your demographic information. Some brief words of thanks. First of all, to our conveners, the Safe Seaweed Coalition and the Zanzibar Seaweed Cluster Initiative, to our keynote speaker and to all of our panelists, to UNGC for hosting the event, to Mary Kate for coming in on holiday to do that, thank you, to the Food Systems Summit Secretariat for all they're doing to put on this summit, to the Food Systems Summit Dialogue team who created the concept of these dialogues, made this space for stakeholder engagement, to the organizing team behind the scenes, especially thanks, Allison, for stepping in and stepping up as showrunner at the last minute due to illness of a team member. Last but emphatically not least, to all of you in the audience, thank you for your active participation and engagement. Let us keep the seaweed revolution going. How did we do? Everybody's eating, living, and breathing seaweed. That is awesome. Can everybody see that? I think that everybody can see that. I think that's a great way to close. Thank you so much. See you all soon. Take care.
Thank you. Bye.